Thank you, mighty Lord Raiden, for blessing us with this new content at this difficult time. And for making it good. Yes, I really enjoyed this, although I have to tell you up front, I'm pretty much a Mortal Kombat newbie. I mean, I covered the Injustice 2 game, and then I stuck with NetherRealm Studios. And so I've been keeping an eye on Mortal Kombat, not only because some DC characters have shown up there, but because the live-action movie's coming up, and so I want to get ready for that. So I've been dipping a toe in the Mortal Kombat waters, and I'm actually surprised how much I know. I noticed a couple, like, more than I would have thought watching this movie. But there are still, I'm sure, plenty of Easter eggs that I didn't catch. For instance, I saw somebody tweet online that they have some cool callbacks to locations from earlier versions of the game. I didn't notice that. But I did catch some key phrases from the game, some that I recognized and some I was like, oh, that's gotta be a phrase from the game. And I have to say, it put a smile on my face. And make no mistake, this movie is largely made for newbies like me. I mean, sure, it's nice. It's a nice treat for the hardcore fans, although you're very difficult to please. However, with a live-action movie on the horizon, Mortal Kombat is clearly looking to expand its overall horizons, grow its fan base. And this animated movie serves as a fantastic introduction to the Mortal Kombat mythology. I also saw some people say, oh, I thought Scorpion was going to be the main character, and why didn't we focus more on just one specific person? You gotta walk before you can run. And again, this is meant, I think, you know, this is entertainment that's meant for hardcore fans, but also to bring in new audience members, and so they need to be oriented first before they can, you know, do a character study. And I'm surprised some people don't recognize that. All right, so anyway, basically, you watch this animated movie and get ready for the live-action movie that's coming up. And at 80 minutes, this is very enjoyable homework. Now, I don't want to give away any spoilers, because the movie has some fun twists and turns, especially if you're a newbie. So I'll touch on a few overall things about the movie, and then I'll do one of my favorite things, and that's list the characters in the order of my favorite. Alright, so, I gotta talk about the violence. Wow! Let me just tell you, don't eat while you're watching this movie. I made the mistake of making hot dogs. So I sat down with my dinner. Oh boy, I'm gonna watch me some Mortal Kombat. This is gonna be a great evening. And in the opening scene, let's just say Scorpion turns a bunch of ninjas into hot dogs. And as I took each bite, I kind of felt like that's what I was eating. It was super gross. But I actually had to look away a couple of times throughout the movie. But interestingly, not just because it was disgusting, whoa, but actually, because I felt bad for the characters. I mean, you could tell how much everything hurt, which is very unusual for animated violence, so that's really a feather in the cap of the creative people here who worked on this. Like, for instance, one thing I felt bad for them. So, like, when Jax entered an arena, I was like, wait a minute, doesn't he have metal arms? Uh-oh. And sure enough, I mean, he didn't get metal arms in this movie, but he got halfway there. He needs some metal arms. I did think that Kano's joke about hugs was pretty funny. Pretty funny trash talk. But poor Jax, his role is teeny tiny. He's basically just there to get his arms ripped off. Well, not totally, actually. I liked what they did with him a little bit later. But I didn't know he was Sonya's commanding officer. I told you, I'm a newbie. And I really liked that connection between the two of them, and I thought it was very well done here. Again, they had to do things in broad, short strokes, but I felt that. I felt that. And it's not just violence, it's beautifully orchestrated violence, thank you very much. The combination of fight choreography, camera angles, and camera movement, and animation no less, so that makes it particularly impressive, all work really well together to create some really cool and visually interesting fight scenes. Like, many times while watching it, I was like, oh, that's cool. I also really like just overall the visual style of the film. It reminded me a bit of Batman Ninja, although not as crazy. I felt it also had a lot of hard rock influences. I just watched Trolls World Tour. I'm gonna do it. I was like, should I bring in Trolls World Tour? But I just felt like the rock trolls would love Mortal Kombat and play it. They kind of had that crossover in my mind to me. See, that's what happens when other people get into this. When you let other people into your fandom, we make comparisons like this. Right, so, it was also really nice to see Warner Brothers using their entire empire to promote another franchise besides DC. Even the Warner Brothers animation logo is Mortal Kombat themed here. I thought that was such a great way to kick things off. So with Mortal Kombat not just getting an animated movie but a live-action film, I would love to see Warner Brothers kind of give this treatment to other franchises. For instance, give me a Harry Potter animated movie. You know you would love it. All right, so let's rank characters. And I'm going to put a picture, actually, of the actor playing them in the upcoming live-action movie, because, again, we're supposed to be starting to prepare for that. So, of course, because of the Hollywood angle, I loved Johnny Cage. To me, he is the gift that keeps on giving. I love all his Hollywood banter and jokes, and he's become a very meta character in the game and also here, able to in many ways almost comment on Mortal Kombat itself. You know, there's still some elements that seem a little 90s, and I think that Johnny Cage commenting on that makes it seem more modern. He's not only a funny character, but I think he's crucial to keeping the series current. And meta is obviously a very popular trend right now. However, he does overshadow like everyone else, right? He takes all the air out of the room. Liu Kang barely registers here. And so I can see why he maybe would have been left out of the live action movie. But thankfully, Ludi Lin, who plays Liu Kang in the live action film, is very charismatic. He'd be tough to overshadow. But is Johnny Cage not in the live action movie? Some of you feel that Louis Tan is playing that character. That's his mystery character. And he did like my tweet saying Johnny Cage was my favorite in this animated movie. I think to make Johnny Cage an Asian superstar would be very, very exciting. I would be very in favor of that because it makes total sense that with today's global market and global interest in kung fu films that you would have an Asian star be that person. I think it's a great idea. We'll see how fans react to it. I saw already some negative comments, but I don't think that's very fair. My only concern would be whether or not Louis Tan is a good enough comedian to pull it off. You gotta be as funny as you are, as good a fighter, to be a good Johnny Cage. Next, I really liked Sonya Blade, and at first, I did not like her. I thought she was over the top and a bit too G.I. Jane. I don't think she needed to kick Johnny in the crotch that many times, quite frankly, alright? But over the course of the film, as we got to know her, I did start to really like her. I love her long animated ponytail. It was very She-Ra or Fox from Gargoyles, right? And wow, can she fight. Just like, well, I don't want to give anything away. But I had more respect for her when I saw her fight. I particularly liked her upside down helicopter kick twirl. I could watch that all day. It was really well animated. Plus, I thought you could see her working hard in her fights. Like, there's one moment when she's fighting in a swamp and she runs real hard to get up some speed and truly has to push herself. You could feel that. And I think it made me appreciate and respect her more and feel like she earned her place in the tournament. Although, in some cases, I was like, you have no powers. How on earth can you beat that other combatant? Alright, so Mortal Kombat, also I want to point out, has done a lot to upgrade its female characters, most recently with the new game, MK11. And now this animated movie, I think Sonya was upgraded. But I would have liked to have actually seen more female characters as a female viewer. Katana shows up briefly, but I didn't love her design here. I didn't like it so much. Although I did think it was a bit of a throwback to the sexier looks for earlier Mortal Kombat games, so maybe some fans would appreciate that fan service. I think if she... I wouldn't have minded her outfit being a little more revealing if I thought her character was plussed in other ways as well. I think you can, by the way, do a balance between a somewhat revealing costume and a stronger female character. I think it can be done. And so I'd be curious to see what the next evolution of these characters is going forward. Because I think that, you know, it's a pendulum effect. I think it'll settle somewhere in the middle. And so everyone will be happy. There's been some debate as to the female characters in MK11 that I've seen online. All right, so anyway, then Raiden. I just thought he was cool. I liked him. I was like, oh, I get Raiden. Raiden is cool. I like how he carries himself and how powerful he is. Plus, lightning is just an amazing visual. Never gets old. And then Scorpion. I know it's called Scorpion's Revenge, and he's like fourth on my list, but he made the list. Not everyone made my list. I had no idea he could teleport. I looked it up. I was like, oh yeah, he could always teleport. I didn't know that. I appreciated it. And also, I never made the connection that his chain is supposed to be like a scorpion's tail. Hello, Megan! I can't believe I missed that. But he's totally Mortal Kombat's Wolverine, even down to the yellow costume. And I don't remember any other depictions of him having an actual scorpion brow, but I got used to it. I liked the character. I also, again, kind of liked Kano, who's totally Mortal Kombat's Boomerang. There are a few other very well-known Mortal Kombat characters here too, but they didn't make as much of an impression. Again, they only have 80 minutes here. But the only thing I felt was a missed opportunity was Shang Tsung, considering how iconic he was in the original live-action film. And of course, they tease a sequel, and I would watch that sequel. I definitely would. They've piqued my interest, you know, in this universe, you know, from a narrative standpoint. So Mortal Kombat Scorpion's Revenge is a great introduction into the mythology and primer for the upcoming live-action movie. But even on its own, I'd say it's definitely one of the best animated films to come out of Warner Brothers Animation. I thought it was very strong, surprisingly strong, and a great first step into expanding, you know, Warner Brothers' treatment of their other franchises. You know, it's not just all, I love DC as much as the rest of you, but I'd love to see that love spread around a bit more. So that's my review of Mortal Kombat Scorpion's Revenge. Share your own thoughts down below, mark spoiler comments as such, please. Subscribe today, and of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.